Walk into a forest, and within 5 minutes, your body and brain start to change. Your heart rate slows. Your facial muscles start to relax. Your hardworking frontal lobes begin to quiet down. And this will boost your productivity and creativity later in the day. I'm Florence Williams, and I've spent the last couple of years writing a book about how being in nature actually makes us more human. Here are some of the things I've learned from the new science looking at nature and our health. The smell of pine trees strengthens your immune system. When you hear birdsong or look at fractal patterns in nature, your brain puts out more alpha waves, making you feel both calm and alert. If you spend an hour and a half walking around living plants and animals, you'll be less preoccupied by your personal problems and feel more connected to people and the world around you. Finnish researchers say being in nature a minimum of 5 hours a month can make you happier overall. Why not give it a try? Go outside. Go often. Bring friends. Breathe.
Florence Williams is a contributing editor at Outside Magazine and a freelance writer for the New York Times, New York Times Magazine, National Geographic, Mother Jones, High Country News, numerous other publications. A fellow at the Center for Humans and Nature and a visiting scholar at George Washington University, her work focuses, as you can imagine, on the environment, health, and science. The Wall Street Journal has called her writing droll and crisp, which she says in her official bio, no less, makes her feel a bit like a pastry. Her first book, Breasts, A Natural and Unnatural History, received the LA Times Book Prize in Science and Technology and was also named a notable book of 2012 by the New York Times. She's joined in conversation tonight by Rob Discher, the Director of Communications and Public Affairs at REI, to hoot for REI, to discuss her latest book, The Nature Fix. That sounded a little bit like Kellyanne Conway telling people to buy Ivanka Trump, didn't it? I'm sorry. I wanted to make some sort of a hometown reference. It came out wrong. At any rate. They're together on this stage in seconds when I get off of it, to discuss her latest book, The Nature Fix, Why Nature Makes Us Happier, Healthier, and More Creative. Please welcome Rob Discher and Florence Williams.
I guess we have to hold our mics.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so welcome to Seattle.
Thank you. It's great to be here. You guys came out on a rainy night. It's awesome.
That's standard fare here in tropical
I know this isn't
February.
Really even rain for you guys. This is just like drizzle.
Yeah. So on a personal note, my wife and I moved here to Seattle about a year ago. And I moved here to take the job at REI. And one of the first things that I read as I was really digging into this connection between health and wellness in the outdoors was the piece that you did for National Geographic, This Is Your Brain on Nature. And it's just always, it's really stuck to my ribs. And as I've gotten to know more of your work, what's been just so amazing is the amount of ground that you cover. And so everybody's here because of The Nature Fix and because of this book, but you cover a hell of a lot of range. And so I'm curious, I think it's an interesting just jumping off point tonight. Why did you get into this subject in the first place?
Okay, good question. I think like a lot of the subjects I write about, there is some kind of personal interest or something personal that happens that drives the interest. And for me, I actually grew up in New York City, so you might not think I'd be a good candidate to write about nature connection. But I had this very crunchy granola dad. And every summer, we would load up the Dodge van with some canoes on top and go run rivers in the West. And my friends in New York City thought that was very strange. And then I got my first job working for High Country News in a small town in Colorado. right after college, and I ended up spending really over two decades in the Rocky Mountains, mostly in pretty small towns, living this really nature-connected, nice life. I had a trail right outside my back door, and I was walking in the mountains every day. And then my husband got offered a job in Washington, D.C., and my kids and I were both like, no, no, don't do it, don't do it. And we lost. So we ended up moving to Washington, D.C. about 4 years ago. And it was kind of hell, I mean, to be honest. Like, it was just this urban, loud, noisy, you know, Euclidean environment with straight lines and monochromatic colors. We landed in July. Sorry, this is a long-winded answer, but we landed in July, and it was 104 degrees, and my hair just went zing like that. And I just felt this profound kind of shift in my brain. It's like this cortisol bomb had gone off, and I had trouble sleeping. I had trouble focusing. I was depressed. I was anxious. And I wondered how much of this was because I just was missing the mountains so much and wasn't kind of getting my nature fix. So the science journalist in me wanted to find out if this sort of idea of nature deficit disorder that Richard Louv talked about in Last Child in the Woods, if it was real, and sort of what the science was saying about it. And so that's what really started me down this path.
That's awesome. One of the things that you cannot miss as you read through this book is the absolutely massive amount of research that you've done in this. You've been all over Asia, you've been all over Europe, you've been all across the United States, talking to people that are on the front lines with this research. So I just think it would be really interesting for the folks here to understand, what did that research process look like? How long did that take you? How many conversations did you have with this thing?
I spent probably 2 years, you know, back and forth, kind of doing field reporting. So it was a lot of time. I was really fortunate to get a couple of assignments from magazines that drove the research, first from Outside Magazine to go to Japan to write about forest bathing, which is this kind of quirky, eccentric practice that involves not taking off your clothes, but hanging out in the woods and learning to use all of your senses to sort of very quickly calm your nervous system. People in Japan are really stressed out, and they're kind of at the forefront of doing some of this research and physiology and what happens to your body and your brain when you're out there. And then I got an assignment from National Geographic, which is the one you read about. And National Geographic, you know, it's one of the few magazines out there that still has a travel budget. And so they sent me to these crazy, you know, nice exotic places like Finland and South Korea. I went to Scotland and many parts of Scandinavia, where they're really kind of at the forefront of, again, doing some of this research really focused around well-being and stress reduction. I mean, there are people doing research in this country too, but interestingly, it was sort of about their focus is sort of about the opposite. It's not so much about stress reduction in this country, I think, with the cognitive neuroscientists, as it is about how to use nature to be more productive, how to use nature to be more creative, because we have such a premium on, you know, create, 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 and take a quick break in nature. If that helps you, go back to work.
So, one of the things you write here is that science is now bearing out what the romantic poets knew to be true. I just found that to be a really, really compelling statement. What do you mean by that? And what is science really saying right now?
Well, I was an English major. I took a class in romantic poetry. I read a lot of Wordsworth. You know, Wordsworth, I think in his lifetime, he walked something like 10,000 miles. He walked across the Alps a couple of times. He was an orphan. Actually really, you know, kind of very traumatic childhood. He was separated from his siblings at a very early age, went to live with, you know, an uncle's family, wasn't a great scene. You know, their money was basically stolen by sort of another crooked relative. And he just talks about how nature, you know, really saved him. He talks about how nature made it possible for him to even have an imagination. And he was very just, I think, prescient, actually, of the neuroscience in talking about how the environment literally resounded inside his mind and enabled him to create. And it, in a way, it just really prefigures what the science is finding out now. So I tried to bring some of that in, even though it's not science, but I just like romantic poetry, so there's some of it in there.
So you're a parent, and you've got two, your own. And I'm imagining that there's a handful of parents here in the audience tonight. I know that I know for sure there's one on the way because my pregnant wife is in the back.
Congratulations.
So in all these different conversations, one of the things you touch on is the impact on children. How has all this research impacted the way that you parent your own kids?
My parents, I mean, my my children are troopers. The job that my husband took was he works for the Wilderness Society. So we actually force our children to go into the wilderness with us. It's where we have to take really all of our vacations. But, you know, we have done this with them since they were very little. They're now 13 and 15. And they just love it, as do most kids. Kids, you know, they love to play. They love to explore. My kids, you know, they fight a lot. But as soon as we go outside when they were little, they would stop fighting. And they would actually start playing together and showing each other cool things they were finding and building forts together and throwing rocks in the river together. You know, I could just see this whole profound change in the way that they kind of navigated their emotions when they're outside. And even though now they're teenagers, my son is 15. He actually has a girlfriend. He'll be mad if I say that maybe on television. There's a video game. But he texts. That's what they do, right? They text. It's like this texting relationship, and he texts a million times a day. It drives me crazy. But I know that this love of nature is in there. It's in his mind somewhere. And it will come back. And he will lean on this affinity he has for the natural world when he needs it. And it will be there for his whole life. You know, kids who learn this love of nature early will always come back to it. And it's this gift that I think parents can give their children, something that will last their whole lifetime.
So you've got people here in the audience. They're going to be, some of them are going to be deep urban creatures here from downtown Seattle. There's going to be probably some folks that are from in the surrounding areas like Issaquah and out in the mountains like that. How did, as you moved from Colorado, deep, almost impossible to miss the outdoors there, into D.C., where it's a little bit harder, how did your parenting style change with them? How did you go and maintain this element through your lives as you transitioned to your actual environment?
Well, one of our tricks was we got a dog, and our being outside became not so much about me being a parent telling my kids to go outside, but the kids actually wanting to give the dog time in the dog's natural environment. You know, if you have a dog, you know that the dog really comes to life outside, right, and does what a dog is meant to do, gets so happy outside. And my kids know that, and they love to take her out. And then the other thing is that we now have to kind of parcel nature out into, you know, more discrete doses. It's not like the daily drip that it was in Colorado. It's more like, okay, let's go somewhere for the weekend, or let's go somewhere for spring break or for summer. I make my kids go to camp. Well, I don't make them. They love camp. They go to camp in the summer. They have to leave their phones at home. They have a great, great time. And it's just heartbreaking to me that not every child can have those kinds of opportunities. And I just feel really passionate about, you know, trying to make nature more accessible for more kids. And I know at REI, you guys, that's a major priority for you, too.
Yeah. You talk about dosing in the book. And you start to introduce this idea that it doesn't necessarily have to be all or nothing. And you talk about how different cultures introduce people to the outdoors and build that relationship in deep urban environments and in more nature-focused environments. Can you talk a little bit more about that, about this idea of a nature dose?
Yeah, I think people wonder, you know, is there sort of a daily minimum requirement?
just make this easy for us.
Right. Give me a prescription. I know I have a daily minimum requirement, and I think it's very variable. I think some people really need it. I know I need it. Some people may need it less. And I think that there are times in our lives when we need kind of an immersion in nature more than at other times. One of the chapters in the book is about women veterans with PTSD. And they have found, some tremendous kind of comfort and relief in deep times in nature. So after trauma, after grief, I think it's important for people to know that actually time in the wilderness can be a great option, a great intervention. Unfortunately, this isn't really something that's talked about by doctors or by psychotherapists or by the VA. It's still a concept that in this country hasn't been medicalized in the same way that it has been in places like South Korea, for example, or in Finland, where health officials actually recommend that people get 5 hours a week minimum, 5 hours a month. It's this very specific recommendation to go into the forest, 5 hours a month, a little over an hour a week to stave off depression. It kind of cracks me up, but they have this they think they know the formula.
Well, and that's something you talk a lot about is this idea of what governments do elsewhere to go and almost make time in the outdoors unavoidable, make it a mandatory thing and really bake it into the fabric of life out there. And so if you had to go import something from another country for us, what would it be?
Well, that's a good question. In both Japan and South Korea, the forest services have baked into their forest plan that the forest should be not just managed for timber and not just managed for recreation, but specifically managed for mental health. It's kind of interesting. So it is baked into their forest plans. And because of that, there are forest healing trails, forest therapy trails, healing forests. South Korea has 500 healing rangers. I went to visit one of the healing forests there, and I stumbled onto a group of firefighters, these big burly guys who were recovering from their stressful jobs. And it was very different from what you would see men doing in forests here, which is typically kind of hunting and fishing. These firefighters were holding hands and doing partner yoga. And then they were making very dainty floral collages. And then they were having a tea ceremony with bark tea. And I was like, wow. And I talked to them and I was like, so what is this like for you? Is this good? And they just said, oh my God, I wish I could stay here forever. It's so what I need right now.
So I really like this idea of that you discuss in the book about nature being a leveler and being an equalizer across genders. And can you just give us an idea of how that actually works and how you've seen that play out in the different cultures, especially within youth?
Yes. I visited some forest kindergartens, and I initially was very skeptical about these because I went to Finland and Scotland where the weather, is really horrible. And I thought, oh God, these poor kids, they're just like getting rained on all day. And they probably just want to eat their cupcakes, and put their heads on the pillows like other preschoolers. But of course they loved it. When I saw, they were running around with their galoshes on, stomping in the mud and having the time of their lives. And I saw little girls climbing, as high as anyone, in these like high tree limbs. I saw little kids running around with hacksaws and 4-year-olds building fires. It's really a different approach to risk management than we have here. And of course, the kids were really, really engaged. And so I went from feeling skeptical to feeling really guilty that I didn't provide this for my children. But seeing the girl, I ran into some studies, heard about some studies that were really interesting. And, there's a problem, of course, with kids not getting enough activity today. We know this is a huge problem. Kids are overweight. They're at risk for, obesity, diabetes, all these things. And we know this because researchers put accelerometers on these little kids and measure how much they run around. And it's shocking. I mean, something like 25% of kids actually get the recommended amount of exercise, which is not very much. It's like an hour of running around a day. And even these kids in preschool don't get it. Hence the term containerized kids. You know, kids kind of go from their stroller to the car seat to like plunked down in front of a screen. So one of the studies showed that in these outdoor schools and forest kindergartens, the girls get the same amount of exercise as the boys. And that may not seem remarkable, but when you do these accelerometer studies in conventional preschools or in urban playgrounds, the boys actually get a lot more exercise than the girls. The girls tend to kind of sit around and the boys are running around. So that's one way that nature is kind of this gender leveler, and I just don't think that's really talked about very much, that nature can be the sort of gendered space or gender equal space.
So what do you say to skeptics that if I say I'm going to go for a trail run, I come back and I feel amazing after that? There are going to be some people that say, you just feel good because you got some good exercise, you got a nice endorphin release. What do you say to people that they're skeptical that being outdoors and being active has any more benefit than doing the exact same thing in our adult containers?
Oh, well, I was skeptical that way too. I thought, you know, this is an exercise effect. You know, sure, you're running around. You feel great because you're getting a workout. But it didn't work for me because I was exercising in D.C. and it just, you know, it wasn't working. And, of course, there are other scientists who have also figured out that they need to try to control for the exercise effect. You know, we know, I mean, exercise has been really proven to be great for mental health. It's proven to be great for cognition. You know, it's kind of like the one thing we know that can, you know, stop aging in its tracks and stop mental decline. So there's a lot of exercise science. And a lot of these studies, for example, in Japan, what they've done is they've sent volunteers to walk in a forest, and then they've measured what happens with their cortisol levels and their heart rate and their blood pressure and their moods. And then they send another group to walk in an urban environment. So they're virtually getting the same amount of exercise, but the effects that they're seeing on the nervous systems are totally different.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So the amount of research you did in this thing, like we said before, is just amazing. What was the conversation actually that you tried to set up? What was the person that you wanted to connect with that you couldn't pin down on this?
I tracked down everyone. I don't know if there's anyone who really avoided me very well.
Okay.
I kind of, yeah.
Impressive.
Yeah.
So on a much more serious topic, as you alluded to before, you spent a lot of time with vets, and a lot of time with female vets in the outdoors. It's something that we've worked on at REI. I know there's a lot of research going into the topic. What did you learn from all of your time that you spent with those ladies in the outdoors about what they were going through and how that time on that trip helped them transition?
There was someone who put it really clearly for me that really brought it home, so I'll say it here, and that's that the wilderness seems to kind of exhibit these anti-PTSD qualities, that the wilderness is this anti-PTSD, it's like this antidote for PTSD. And kind of what that means is that, you know, symptoms of PTSD involve things like really feeling shut off from the world, closed off, you're very socially isolated. Some of the women veterans I met hadn't left their houses, like honestly very much for a couple of years. They were replaying, you know, painful scenes, nightmares, very high anxiety, high levels of fear. And when I watched them in the wilderness, sort of all the opposite things happened. They weren't replaying their own episodes in their minds. They were paying attention to what was happening in front of them because they had to. They were like in a rubber ducky going down a rapid, and there was a rock coming at them, and you know, and then the rain came, and they, you know, so it sort of demanded their focus, you know, in this really engaging way. It also really facilitated social connections with each other. the bonds that the women formed on the wilderness trip. I spent a week on a river trip with a group of women. Those bonds have continued a couple of years later. They told me that they slept better outside than they had in years. And I think there's something, too, about really profound natural beauty that, you know, facilitates this positive emotion of awe. And there's actually a whole kind of line of studying about awe, like these awe studies. And what they show is that when we experience awe, it takes us outside of ourselves and makes us feel part of something larger, which is it really does seem to be kind of the opposite of PTSD. And by doing that, it also makes us feel more connected to each other.
So you're right down the street here from Microsoft and from Amazon. Seattle has an amazing tech community that's doing some pretty incredible things. And you spent some time with a researcher who was trying to essentially fake the human body into thinking that it was outdoors. So, and the actual experience sounded like it was a little bit painful, but I'm just curious if you think that we'll ever get to the point where you'll be able to simulate the real thing and the impact that it has on people.
There are a lot of people out there trying to do that, of course. Virtual reality, you know, is a thing, and why leave the couch, you know, if you can just turn on your 3D headset and be in a beautiful place without having to take the plane, you know, and spend the money. I think that this has some upsides for people, for example, solitary confinement prisoners. You know, they really can't, you know, go to Hawaii. There are some really interesting studies looking at nature videos and solitary confinement prisoners, and these studies show that these prisoners actually do feel much calmer and feel better. And at first, their guards were like, no, we don't want them to feel better. Why should we provide happy experiences for them? But then they realized actually that the prisoners were having far fewer violent episodes. There were, you know, they were easier to manage when they were exercising in a room with nature videos. So now it's kind of, there are more and more prisoners signing on to this. But I'm also, you know, I of course worry that if we can provide these artificial experiences, that then we'll have even fewer reasons to actually go leave our houses and then to conserve nature. Because why do you need to save it if you can invent it?
So I know that we wanted to open this up to the questions from the audience, but one last question. So you and your husband both work full time. You've got two kids. You live in D.C. You're on the road. It seems like 24/7. You've got a million people pulling at you. I was just talking to the editor from Outside Magazine yesterday who said that they literally cannot get enough Florence Williams in their life. So when you just want to go shake it off, how do you get your nature fix? How do you find time in the schedule to go do this?
I think that's a great question because I think we all have these pressures on our lives, right? I mean, everyone works hard. We all have a million demands. So we have to, I mean, it would be great to just go into the wilderness, you know, with my friends, right, whenever I felt like it. I just can't do it, and neither can most people. So we have to figure out how to integrate nature, you know, into our everyday lives. And sometimes it's not going to be spectacular. It's going to be, you know, in very small doses and micro bursts. And it takes an effort, but I think it's totally worthwhile because then we have the energy and the resilience to sort of get through all the other drudgery in the day. So.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
So if you do have a question, we just ask that you come up to either one of the microphones and please keep your question in the form of a question.
Would you talk a little bit more about what a microdose might look like? You know, for a busy person or a kid who maybe doesn't have access to all the resources of nature, what is it that's sort of that little bit that can make the difference?
Great question. You know, there are some people who claim that even houseplants, let me talk about a microdose, that there are some experiments that we'll put subjects in a room with houseplants and subjects in a room without houseplants, and give them tests of, like, play these, you know, psychology games with them where you have to, you know, keep or give away money or keep or give away lottery tickets. And kind of what happens is that in the rooms with the houseplants, people actually act more generously towards each other. They give away more money. They give more money to charity just because of the houseplants. Okay, so that's a microdose. I'm also a big fan of pets. You know, I mean, pets are, you know, they're another species, you know, with whom we have an affinity and an affiliation. It's kind of a way, you know, to have this, like, cross-species connection. You know, time in the backyard. There are some doctors in D.C. where I live who are prescribing nature to their patients, to their children patients. And one of the things they're suggesting is, like, okay, so you walk to school this way, but why don't instead you walk this way where there are more trees? So, you know, change up your routine a little bit so that you're just walking where there are more trees. You know, some of these patients end up enjoying it so much that they decide to walk a little farther, or they decide to walk through, you know, spend more time on a park route if they can find a safe one, you know, or go with friends. So once we start acknowledging that nature makes us happy, and that's a big problem because I think a lot of us kind of undervalue it, then I think, you know, we start to find more creative ways to get a little more and a little more and a little more.
I work in education research, and I've been trying to get a study going for ages on the impact of more hiking and I guess outdoorsy stuff for students and the impact that it has on them. And I've had a hard time finding references, so I'm curious to hear if you've read any research that looks at the impacts of nature on students.
I would send you to a great resource called the Children and Nature Network, which has done a great job of documenting a lot of studies looking at the impacts of nature on learning and cognition, childhood development. Tons of studies up there. I think a lot more need to be done. Many of the studies out there are too small, you know, and they can be sort of picked apart. But there are some really good ones and more all the time. So Children and Nature Network, check it out. Thanks for your work. It's great.
Hi, Florence.
Hi.
You describe in your book the moving truck pulling up to your place in Boulder and just crying with one of your neighbors about the fact that you're moving to D.C.
I cry a lot.
I'm curious how your kids have adjusted to living in the big city, how they're enjoying it, and whether you have long-term plans to eventually move back into the West.
Okay, so my daughter was, I think, 8 when we moved, and my son was 10, about that. And my daughter was mad at us for a year. So she was, like, slamming doors. part of it was, I think she was queuing off me because I had to drive her across town in D.C., you know, terrible traffic. And sometimes I would just burst into tears because, you know, there was I would take the wrong lane or there was too much traffic or I couldn't get there. And so I calmed down eventually with a little more time in nature. And now they're doing great. You know, I mean, kids are super adaptable. They're super flexible. They have found things they love. They have friends. And they go to summer camp. So, yeah, I would love to move back west someday. And someday, you know, I probably will. But I've got a kid in high school, another one right behind him. So it gets a little more complicated, you know. But if you want to offer me any great real estate in Colorado, let me know.
Hi, I would like to know if there's any research that totally took you by surprise.
Yeah, thanks. Great question. I was not surprised by the research showing that nature boosted our moods or made us, you know, feel good. I was surprised by the research showing that we become more generous in nature, that we also seem to act, you know, in a more communitarian way. I kind of, you know, I spent a lot of time in nature alone, and I sort of thought, well, it's good for me. But it turns out it is really good for community ties and social ties. I think it was John Muir who has a line about wilderness being important for civilization. That's actually wilderness that makes us civilized. And the science really bears that out, and that did surprise me.
Florence, I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the effect of nature on the human senses. Are some of our senses calmed by nature, others more fired up when we're out in nature?
Okay, nature. Well, so I'm glad you asked that. I organize my book by dose. So the first part of the book, I talk about what happens in our brains, you know, with really quick nearby nature exposure. And then I talk about sort of more intentional visits to nature, and then the last third is really about wilderness. But so the first part is the senses, because the senses are how we engage with our environment right off the bat. I can just give you a couple of examples. I had a really interesting time talking to a physicist who studies fractal physics, and he is convinced that kind of like the secret weapon to why nature makes us feel better is because of fractal patterns. And he's done some experiments in this where he'll you know, scan people's brains and measure their wavelengths while they look at different pictures of fractal geometry and fractal dimensions. And in a certain fractal dimension, a fractal geometry is basically a pattern that's repeated at scale. Occurs often in nature, coastlines, cloud formations, trees, tree branches, ripples in a creek or waves. These are fractal patterns. Our perceptual systems evolved in these environments. Our perceptual systems really were designed to read stimuli from natural environments, not from urban environments. And he thinks that when we look at fractal patterns of a certain dimension, not too complex, not too simple, we get in this happy place where we produce more alpha waves, which are sort of the calm, alert zone of our brains. It's sort of like the holy grail of Buddhist monks. And also that there's something about this fractal dimension that also releases kind of dopamine, feel-good hormones in our brains. And that we just really don't get to look at this fractal geometry very often because we're in these really human-built environments with straight lines. So that's just one example. But yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff. The smells are really cool.
Hi.
Hi.
So Seattle's growing really quickly right now, and it's changing a lot. And there are a lot of conversations around like urban planning and use of space and density. And I'm curious if you have seen any neat examples from around the world that, I don't know, maybe we could implement here to make it easier to experience wilderness when we don't have time to get out at the end of the day, or maybe you're going to be around for the weekend. Essentially, if you were the head of urban planning in Seattle, like what would you do?
That's a great question. Yes, I learned that in 2000, and I think it was 8, we became officially an urban species, that more people around the world now live in cities than don't live in them. So that was kind of a major threshold in our habitat as a species. And something like 2 billion more people will live in cities by 2030. So it's a really important question. And I wanted to visit the future. So I went to Singapore, which is the third densest city on the planet. And it's really like high rise upon high rise upon high rise. And yet, it's both a city and a country. It's a country that really valued green space. And through this sort of benevolent dictator who had a vision, they planted millions of trees in Singapore. And they have incredible policies there. So 20 years ago, Singapore was like 35% green space, and then 2 million more people moved in, and now Singapore is 50% green space. So they've actually increased the percentage of, whereas where I live in Washington, D.C., it's been the exact opposite. Like our tree cover is now 38% instead of 50% that it was 15 years ago or 20 years ago. And the policies that they've enacted are things like if you build a high rise, you have to more than replace the green space that you take up. So these buildings have roof gardens. The parking lots, you know, are have parks on top of them. And this is kind of neat. I mean, Singapore has really mastered the vertical garden so that the walls of these skyscrapers are alive, you know, in a sort of creepy way. I mean, they're like moving around and wiggling, and there are sedges, and there are butterflies and birds like hanging out, you know, on these vertical gardens. And it's really kind of a magical space. So that actually gave me some hope that you can do a better job of designing urban areas, designing housing facilities, designing office buildings, you know, in a more biophilic way than we have been doing now. But I think it does take a lot of leadership. It takes a vision, you know, it takes a lot of resources. So I think the challenge, you know, is how to get our leaders to prioritize it, you know, for our schools and our neighborhoods.
One thing I've heard from someone is that they felt safer in like the hood environment than they would in out in nature. And I was curious if you'd encountered a barrier for folks that had been only exposed to urban environments and are actually scared of the wilderness.
Oh yeah, definitely. Part of that is, you know, that's a symptom of our epic dislocation from nature. I mean, kids today don't grow up feeling comfortable in nature, but it's also a statement about the state of our parks. You know, many urban parks are not that safe, and they don't feel safe. You know, Jane Jacobs, who, you know, brilliant thinker about urban life, actually kind of hated parks. I mean, she thought they were places of crime and decrepitude, and that the streets were actually much more vibrant, safe places. And that was what parks were like in the 60s. You know, they were kind of creepy places. Scotland has woodlands everywhere. And I visited Glasgow, where the parks around the public housing facilities are super sketchy. In fact, like drug addicts wheel these garbage bins, plastic garbage bins, into the parks, and they light them on fire, and then they get high from the fumes. So the parks are like filled with drug addicts, and then, you know, this detritus left over from burned wheelie—they call them wheelie bins. So now there's this big effort in Scotland to clean them up, and they've hired forest rangers to sort of take, you know, kindergarten kids and nursery school kids into the parks. And when you do that, then, you know, women feel safer walking in the parks, and there are programs to get groups of women walking in the parks. Because when parks are used, then they're safer. So I think there's like two problems going on there. You know, one is the state of the parks, and the other is just introducing kids to nature at a much younger age, so it doesn't feel so foreign.
So I was curious about like if any studies have been done in terms of comparing different types of wilderness experiences, whether there's a difference between like looking at horizons or trees or deserts, and then also like active versus passive use of parks. If there's studies, you know, more looking at are the benefits still the same or are they different?
So it turns out there's actually quite a bit of variability. You know, one person's idea of a great nature scene is not someone else's. Some people just love the ocean, and that's where they want to go. And other people get kind of freaked out by how wide open the ocean is. There are some studies in the UK that I know of that kind of rate different types of landscapes and landforms. And I mean, the Brits do love their coastlines, and they have determined that the coastlines are the happiest places. And in fact, there are some studies that show that people who live on the coast, as opposed to somewhere else, like that gain in happiness is sort of equivalent to the gain of like being married for the first time or getting a great new job. There's a really profound shift. And so there's one researcher there, Ian Alcock, who has a line, something like, if you want to be really happy, live on the coast and get married often.
I'm currently reading a biography on Theodore Roosevelt, and I've been amazed that as a Republican president, how fundamental he believed it was a national priority to protect wilderness and get people out in it. Despite the current administration from being in D.C. for a while, do you have any hope that that could return to being a national priority? And if so, what average people could do to help propel that?
Oh, boy. Well, I have this idea that we should all bring potted plants to Congress so that they can behave more generously. Right? And we could call it the ficus campaign. And then we could make them go on picnics together and field trips. T-Rex, right? He was amazing. A man who suffered incredible tragedies and losses and knew that he could find comfort, you know, on a horse on the Great Plains and recover and then go back and become like, you know, hyper-productive president. The fact that he was a Republican, you know, I think is something we need to keep reminding our Republicans, you know, that nature love is a bipartisan issue. It's something that, you know, people have seemed to have forgotten. I don't know. I mean, do you have suggestions? I don't know. That's a tough one. It just bums me out that nature has become a politicized space. I'll just recount one anecdote, which is that I recently wrote an article about the Girl Scouts. And so I spent some time at kind of an extreme winter survival skills Girl Scout camp in a rural part of Colorado. And it was very moving to me to meet all these girls, some of whom came from military families, some of whom came from church groups, some of whom came from families that you know, loved riding ATVs and hunting, and others came from these kind of like more granola families. And so clearly these were girls from all across kind of the economic and political spectrum, and they were having a great time together, and it didn't matter, you know, where they were from. They just loved, you know, shooting arrows and riding horses and digging snow caves. And it gave me a lot of hope.
Yeah, when I'm tending houseplants or I'm in my garden, we have a big garden, I'm kind of imposing my will on nature a little bit. I'm deciding where plants will live and which ones will live and so on and so forth. But every couple of weeks when I get up into the mountains and drive over the pass, it's just incredibly refreshing. It's like I'm in an arena where I'm not imposing my will, or when I hike and go off trail, suddenly I'm in an area where there is no attempt to impose human will. And it seems to me magically and qualitatively different to be in that kind of places which are spectacularly beautiful without the human hand trying to having a part to play. And I wonder if that difference makes a difference.
I hadn't thought about it that way, but I think it's a great point. And I think it gets to the crux of some of those awe studies that I mentioned. I mean, really, the definition of awe is something that is vast and also something that is a little bit hard to comprehend. And I think when we're in a space where we don't have control, and when we're not the actor, then that's when we have the sense that the world is bigger than we are, which is really important for our sense of ourselves and our place in the world.
What are you interested in now? What questions do you have that you're chasing?
Good question. I am really interested now in sort of the intersection of gender and the environment. Gender's having a moment And I do feel like a lot of the environmental movement hasn't really been focused on that or interested in it. So that's one place I'd like to go. And I'm also, I just really am passionate about the kid piece as well. I think that, you know, if we don't get these kids out and interested in nature, we're going to lose, you know, the chain will be broken in a way. And then they won't be able to introduce their kids to nature. And that freaks me out. I don't know, Rob, do you have any ideas about places to investigate next?
I really like the ficus idea. I think we should go there.
Yeah, okay, ficus campaign.
I think that's next.
I saw this, I heard this thing on NPR one time, last summer actually, and they're talking about how the scientists were testing people that they went to the beach and watched the sunset, and they said that the beach itself and the waves and the sound of them and the turquoise and the, you know, all the colors, you know, produced the same effect as meditation, right? And so they asked a Buddhist monk about this, and as they, you know, ask him if the science proved that this was true, would he change his belief? And he said, yes, he would. So that's a good thing about Buddhism. But, you know, I sort of wonder if you heard about this, and would a trip to the rainforest do the same thing?
Yes, I have heard people ask this. You know, meditation has been held up as, you know, kind of this wonderful tool in which to improve our moods and our relationships and our minds. Everyone I know is trying it or doing it. I did talk to one kind of nature researcher. He studies sound and birdsong specifically. I have a whole chapter on birdsong. And he says, you know, meditation is great, but let's face it, you have to learn how to do it. And not everyone sticks with it. It has this kind of adherence problem. Some people can't do it at all. And he's like, but nature, it's just there. Everyone can go look at nature. The studies do show that there are some people who will never really calm down in nature. Like, for whatever reason, they just will never be relaxed in nature. They're too freaked out by the birds or the insects or the wind or whatever. There's a small subset. Woody Allen, you know. Woody Allen once said, he said, I love nature, I just don't want any of it on me.
Hi, I work in the field of environmental education. Great. And that's actually a term that I really don't like, because I think all education should just include that. It's just all just good education. And I really struggle with how compartmentalized environmental fill-in-the-blank has come, and it's become separate from the rest of what we study. Like, even at many universities, there's a college of the environment, and yet it's so interlinked with everything else. Why do you think this has happened, and what can we do to make the environment and exposure to the outdoors more universalized, especially given that there are significant socioeconomic barriers to so many?
Yeah, boy, those are hard questions. I think I feel like I can answer the first one better, which is, why has this happened? And I think, you know, we just have a long Western Judeo-Christian culture of thinking we're separate from nature. It's just permeated everything. I think other cultures don't have that in the way that we do. In terms of how to solve it, you know, on the one hand, you know, we like to think parents should kind of run the show and expose their kids to these things, expose their kids to nature, but it doesn't really realistically always happen at the family level, also because of like deep cultural reasons. And so that's why I think schools need to step up. I think our institutions need to step up. I actually think programs like REI's Opt Outside, which got like 6 million people outside on Black Friday, you know, these are massive education campaigns that actually get kids out. It takes a lot of resources. But fortunately, I think there's a lot of activity in the donor community that's really prioritizing this and recognizing it. I don't know. What else?
I think that what we've tried to do at REI is just give people an opening to make a choice to go prioritize the outdoors. And I think that when you look at something like opt outside, it's pretty easy what you're balancing that against. And I think that the more you just kind of just give people a window to do something like that, to go have on one hand a packed aisle and all the madness that happens around Black Friday, on the other hand, getting to have the experience that my wife and I did, where we were just out here on Black Friday. We didn't go far outside of Seattle, but we went to one of the little trails, and it was packed. And there were REI employees out there, which was really cool to see, because they would have otherwise been staffing Black Friday, which is just a horrendous experience in the retail business. And instead, they're out there doing what we were doing, walking our 130-pound bulldog.
This will be our last question.
Hi, thanks for speaking tonight. My name's Nicole. I grew up outside. I grew up in Montana. And because of that, we have way fewer people outside just because we have way fewer people in Montana. So when I go outside, a lot of what I really love is just to be by myself in the outdoors. And my question then is, if in your studies you've noticed any difference in being outside and having there be a lot of people around, or being in groups, or if there's something to be said for just being by yourself outdoors.
I've actually thought about that a lot, because I'm also someone who loves to be outside by myself. And I think for me, a priority is, sort of problem solving. Like, I sometimes write in my head when I'm outside. It's when I really, sort of figure out things that are important to me. I value that so much because I just don't feel like I get enough kind of alone time otherwise. And I'm sort of an introvert, I guess. But I think it depends what you want. I do think that the outdoors is a great place to facilitate social bonds and social ties. And there are times in our lives when, that's really a priority. So if you're out there for mental health and creativity, I think it might be better to be by yourself. If you want a great time with your girlfriends, and there are things to talk about, it's better than sitting at a bar, or it's another alternative to sitting at a bar. It's okay to go to a bar too. But then go outside and work it off. Well, on that note, let's all go to a bar. Thank you so much.